Hi everybody, welcome to CUBE Conversations. This is Dave Vellante and I'm with Stu Miniman. And we're going to give you a preview of VMworld 2014. It's coming up. It used to be Labor Day, kicked off the fall season. Now it's VMworld, Stu.
Absolutely.
So VMware's interesting, right? I mean, $5+ billion software company growing 18% a year. Things are all looking good. Ecosystem's growing. But there's some interesting transitions going on at VMware now. What's going on?
Sure, Dave. So, VMware, boy, has it expanded. This will be our fifth year bringing theCUBE to the show. It was very much about the hypervisor. And of course, the last couple of years, many have said the hypervisor has been commoditized. The competition has been chipping away at VMware's lead. Last numbers I saw was VMware at about 64%. I think Microsoft's at like 16%, and Red Hat wasn't far behind, double digits, I think 11, 12%. So starting to see some encroachment, but VMware is still the standard in the data center. And VMware has been going, growing into the new areas, heavy in cloud with like the vCloud hybrid service. The software-defined data center is the main strategy to extend the hypervisor, so everything going on in the storage and network virtualization world, and trying to grow the TAM for VMware's business without eating its whole ecosystem. A real tough thing to do. We said when Pat Gelsinger took the reins of the company that he needed to be able to do for VMware what Intel has done so well for more than a decade, which is continue to differentiate, keep that leadership without eating the companies that helped grow where they started from.
And what a run, right? I mean, it's like a football dynasty, really. I mean, you're talking about some of the market share, gains or ebbs and flows, but VMware really still is the dominant hypervisor, but it's not just about the hypervisor anymore, right? The theme of the conference is no limits. So what does that mean to a practitioner, no limits?
Well, so Dave, if the virtualization administrator has become critically important to running the data center, in many ways VMware's helping to get out of those silos. It's not just about storage or networking or my individual bespoke piece of hardware, but it is making, rather than the hardware, the asset that I manage, whether it be the server or the like, it's the virtual machine has become the management layer, and the question we've had is, is that going to be the limit, or will the application in the future really take things over with things like Docker really taking a lot of buzz over the last year, and it definitely will be encroaching in on the message at VMworld.
Well, ever since I've been in this business, it's really the applications are really what's driving the value. So let's talk about Docker a little bit. We asked Pat Gelsinger at EMC World about Docker and the whole notion of containerization and increasing developer flexibility such that they can write code and have it deployed on any cloud. And his comment was, well, who's got the best container technology and the largest container platform in the world? It's VMware. But Docker is causing a lot of people to sort of rethink the whole application paradigm. What's going on there in your mind?
Yeah, so Dave, first of all, I expected VMworld that we're going to see VMware embracing Docker even more, because while Docker definitely can give you some portability, not only between clouds, but between hypervisors, we've seen Red Hat with the latest Red Hat 7 just build Docker functionality right into the top. So if I'm doing Linux, Red Hat Linux, I get the Red Hat virtualization there and I can get Docker on top of it. We've heard Microsoft moving forward with some Docker initiatives. I mean, Satya Nadella made a comment during DockerCon that Azure is working to be able to embrace Docker. So of course we're going to see Docker at VMworld. I know there's at least a session. Ben Galoob from Docker is going to be on stage, in one of the sessions with the VMware people. And of course we're going to get Docker on the CUBE program to dig into it a little more.
So let's talk a little bit about the ecosystem. On VMware's last quarterly conference call, they talked a lot about NSX and NSX adoption. They seem to be very enthused. They said they couldn't be more pleased with vSAN. These are fundamental parts of the stack that any software company that's a platform company is going to continuously eat away at, right? And force the ecosystem to find new territory. How is VMware's relationship with the ecosystem? How is it changing? And again, what does it all mean?
Yeah, so very interesting, because they come, NSX and vSAN come at things from really the opposite end of the market. So NSX was really built back when it was Nicira to deliver network virtualization and allow the largest networks in the world to be able to simplify their operation using things like overlays and underlays, so that I'm not managing equipment anymore. It's going to allow services to be delivered in the network the way that in many ways they are from a compute standpoint. And it's been a delicate balance that VMware needs to partner with the hardware companies because, of course, the software needs to live somewhere eventually. And there are competing positions out in the marketplace, most notably with Cisco, who's got application-centric infrastructure, or ACI, as to where they think it should go. Of course, Cisco very much wedded with, this is the software of the future, and of course, it's going to work with our hardware, maybe a little bit of flexibility on some of the controllers and the like, as opposed to VMware is, here's our software, and you're going to be able to choose who your hardware vendor is, whether it be, Arista or HP or Juniper or a bunch of the other new players, or even white box equipment, things from Cumulus and others. So that, is giving a lot of options, and we're definitely seeing, some hits in the marketplace. From what I hear, they're making some good progress. The latest that they said is they have hundreds of customers that are in some level of deployment of NSX. And there's definitely a huge FUD in the marketplace trying to slow down or stall what's going on. Do you want me to pause there, or you want to talk about VSAN?
Well,
too?
I wanted to comment on what you said. Yeah. I mean, it used to be pretty clean, right? A software company, they love all hardware companies. We're hardware agnostic. But now, with the whole software-defined data center, you start to see software really in a viable way encroach upon traditional hardware markets. You see Intel getting deeper and deeper into software, Microsoft actually getting a little bit into hardware, or at least picking at the stack. Certainly Oracle is now, big chunk of Oracle's revenue comes from hardware post Sun acquisition. So we're sort of seeing that reconsolidation of the stack and of the value chain. So I guess my question on the ecosystem is, if you're an ecosystem player, do you feel as though I said it again, we'll come and talk about EMC and the whole federation, that VMware is giving clear direction to the ecosystem so they know where the white space is, where their swim lanes are. Are they doing a good job there?
So I think for NSX they are, and an interesting thing is if we talk about vSAN, some of the rumors that we're hearing is that that VMware is going to come out with some kind of, I guess you might call it a hyper-converged solution. The code name that keeps getting thrown out is Marvin, in which case it's going to be VMware vSAN with an appliance and sold. So if you talk about those swim lanes, vSAN is a software solution. They've got technology partners, what they call the vSAN ready nodes with the likes of Dell and IBM, and I think Cisco might even have one, and looking for server partners that can work with VMware, and if VMware offers their own option there, then it kind of breaks down those swim lanes, as you will, and VMware is going to be encroaching on them. The note I'll say on that is while NSX is trying to hit some of the largest parts of the market, vSAN is starting out into the smaller environments. Typically, companies that either have a project or just want all their storage isn't going to fit on a traditional storage array. In many ways, it's still looking to displace that dumb JBOD, DAS type technology, because vSAN is server-based technology, what we've called server SAN at Wikibon, and they're taking that to the next step, and eventually it can grow and be disruptive against other companies, closest to things like what Nutanix does and maybe a little bit what SimpliVity does, but eventually it could go into kind of that mid-market storage array business, which is a very busy market these days.
Let's talk a little bit about clouds. I mean, last year, the year before, a lot of buzz around OpenStack, but the real action in cloud is still Amazon AWS, Microsoft Azure is really coming on strong. The vCloud hybrid service, you get mixed opinions on that, you get mixed results, but very clearly, the big whales, Amazon, Google, Microsoft are breaking the ice, setting the trends there. What's going on? How does VMware compete? We know they compete in hybrid cloud, on-premise, but long-term, how do they compete? Give us the cloud update.
Yeah, Dave. So first of all, a year ago, Pat Gelsinger told the partner community, when Amazon wins, we lose. So it was trying to make it very much a war of Amazon versus the VMware ecosystem. And what's been a tough sell on that is, from what I hear from the ecosystem partners, is they're not sure how to add value and really make good money and good margins on what VMware is doing with vCloud hybrid services. We saw at EMC World this year, that has now become, vCloud hybrid service has become a federation asset, which means that not only is VMware and VMware's partner selling it, but EMC is using it as a good piece of their cloud strategy. So you're going to have EMC sales reps and the channel partners all trying to push this, but it's still not clear to me how all the partner community and the services can help grow that. So it is moving forward. It definitely has matured a lot in the last year, but I would say that VMware's hybrid strategy still lags behind what Microsoft is doing with Azure. Of course, most people have that Microsoft applications inside and working with things like Office 365 in the cloud. And of course, Amazon is still the clear leader in the public space. So VMware, while they are a huge leader inside the data center, they haven't quite figured out how to nail that go-to-market partner strategy and the applications going forward as to, you know, where is VMware's place in the application portfolio, because you know most of it's either Microsoft or it's Linux, and they have strong competitors there, or it's going pure in the cloud with what Amazon's doing, or you know really I guess the close partner that VMware has is Pivotal, who we expect to see some at VMworld, but that gets back to the federation.
Yeah, so I mean you see Amazon growing very, very rapidly, although you know last quarter there was indications that because of pricing pressures it didn't grow as fast. I think it grew 38%. You know, year on year, still enormous growth for an organization that's going to do $4 to $5 billion, probably closer to $5 billion this year. You're seeing Microsoft make inroads. They you know, peaked up in the Gartner Magic Quadrant. Google seems to be getting more serious, although it's Google, so you know, you never know how committed they are.
Yeah, VMware does not compete against that race to zero cloud. It is the, you know, Amazon and Google and Microsoft, and you know, you're not going to see VMware coming out here saying, you know, we're going to drop our prices 5 times a year and compete with these guys. It's a different value proposition.
But one could argue, Stu, that the outsourcing business, that notion of outsourcing infrastructure provisioning and deployment and all the heavy lifting associated with that is now getting cloudified and will have marginal economics that are very much more like software. So the fact that they don't compete in that so-called race to zero, because they can't compete really in that race to zero, is that a threat to companies like VMware and EMC and IBM and HP, because they don't have the volume?
Yeah, so definitely, Dave, it's going to be the real challenge over the next, you know, 3 to 5 years is to, you know, where do the applications live? Of course, VMware's done a great job of allowing, my existing infrastructure, my existing applications to live on, and they're trying to extend that into the cloud. So companies that, you know, are moving slowly, you know, VMware's going to keep up with them, going to be able to take what you have today and extend it into some kind of futures. But for those that are willing to, you know, jump right into the kind of the cloud mobile world, as it were, it's going to need to be either through Pivotal, through Amazon, or through someone else, and VMware is threatened to be left behind in a world like that.
Well, the argument is that there's going to be a lot of hybrid clouds. You talk to customers and they believe that. But one has to wonder, what's the blind spot out there that nobody can see? If the economics dramatically change, maybe the customers can't see what's coming, or maybe the corner office, like we heard at Philips last week, totally changes how they're going to do business with companies. So obviously we'll be watching that. So I've slipped a couple of times, injecting EMC into the equation. That's the big elephant in the room. Elliott Asset Management has said they want EMC to fully divest of its, or at least largely divest of its VMware ownership. Currently, EMC owns about 85% of VMware. Over half its market cap.
EMC's.
Over half of EMC's market cap is accounted for by the value of VMware's stock that they own. So a lot of people are pressing EMC to fully divest of, or at least largely divest of VMware, give up that controlling stake and let the flowers bloom. So I don't think that's ever going to happen, certainly under Tucci's watch, but Tucci's going to retire next year, supposedly, right? At least that's the word. What do you make of all this, Stu? Should EMC divest of its VMware stock? Would it be a good thing for VMware? Would it be a good thing for EMC? Would it be a good thing for the industry?
So, I mean, Dave, you know, we've heard Joe Tucci speak many times that the Federation plan is the plan. This isn't something they're trying. This is something that they're hugely
committed
to. It's
not an experiment, right?
This is not an experiment. you know, my take on it is I'm actually impressed by this strategy. So, Dave, I've been involved with the EMC-VMware relationship since the beginning. I was at EMC at the time it happened. I was one of the first handful of people working on it. And to be honest, the relationship between EMC and VMware went through, you know, a huge up and down. So the year and a half before the acquisition, EMC was a very strategic, important partner. EMC, you know, largest storage player out there. You know, I was calling up lots of EMC's partners to help get VMware equipment, educate them, work on their roadmap with them. After the acquisition itself, it was funny. For a couple of years, from an engineering standpoint, EMC had to be the least of the storage partners. So HP and IBM and Dell
and
NetApp had to get things before EMC did. So it actually slowed down some of the engineering work. Change in management happened, you know, on both sides. Diane Greene left, and management changed on these.
Left,
yes. and we're seeing some of Diane's, you know, companies showing up in the ecosystem again, which is quite interesting. But, you know, if you talk from a strategy standpoint, you know, many of the companies I talk to talk about EMC and VMware in the same breath. At the very top, we know that they are joined at the hip and they're going in a certain direction. Now, of course, the position of the Federation is they're going to compete against each other and they're going to give you choices. So if you want to do Pivotal, you can run that on Amazon. If you're working with, you know, VMware, of course you're going to work with all the other storage guys. And from an EMC standpoint, they're going to move forward. They made some great announcements recently with Microsoft Azure. You know, not as close with you know, Amazon these days, but you know, it's not just about VMware. So all of those three major pieces are going to work with the other partners, and they're going to drive a joint strategy forward that I think makes a lot of sense. You know, I don't see how it benefits EMC to get rid of the VMware assets. It only helps them to have those kind of under that joint management.
Yeah, so whether or not it's better for VMware or the ecosystem or the industry is sort of academic, because in my mind, there's no way EMC is going to give up this asset. It would be stupid, in my opinion, for EMC to do that. What would be the motivation? They are able to get, you know, VMware value, the market certainly understands VMware's value proposition. The issue, there's a lot of value of EMC's core business that's locked inside of EMC, but my feeling is that over time, markets will determine whether or not that value should be unlocked, and I would think it would be just really a dumb move for EMC to spin that up, because EMC without VMware is a much less interesting company, much less strategic for CIOs, so now with the Federation story, they can go in and make that argument
much
stronger.
Dave, we're starting to see some, you know, interesting solutions. So a vCloud hybrid service is the platform for cloud. There's EMC services that are on top of that. There's Pivotal services that are on top of that. Things like the Desktone acquisition that VMware made plays into some of these components. You know, vBlocks, you know, potentially fit into those vCloud hybrid services. So the interplay between the members of the Federation give them some nice offerings.
So as long as EMC's throwing off cash, it's going to keep buying VMware stock to keep that 85%. Let's talk about mobile and end-user computing. Sanjay Poonen is about a year in now. Sanjay Poonen is an executive that VMware hired from SAP. Sharp guy, made the AirWatch acquisition. Big moves. We've seen VMware do many iterations of what used to be called VDI and is now they call it term as end-user computing. Are they getting it right?
So, first of all, Dave, I think they're getting it right because it's now a mobile strategy. I remember before the AirWatch acquisition, I was talking to Brian Madden and I said, you know, how do they have a real end-user computing strategy and not, you know, a VDI strategy? And it was they need MDM. So AirWatch fills that gap. They did the Desktone acquisition to help bring some of the desktop solutions to the cloud. And I think we're starting to see a more unified, not just end-user computing on the own, on its own, but it feeds into the cloud strategy, it feeds into the rest of the VMware strategy and the rest of the Federation strategy. So that's a strong play for them.
All right, Stu, we got to wrap it. I'll give you the last word. You got your VM, your VExpert shirt on. So, you know, congratulations. You've been a VExpert for several years now. Small group of cadre of individuals that are sort of very much into the VMware ecosystem and understanding what's happening both technically and from a business standpoint and from the ecosystem. So what should we be watching for? Just give us the summary at VMworld 2014 in San Francisco next week.
Okay, so first of all, Dave, as we said, if it's no limits is the theme of the show, where are the limits? Is the ecosystem going to help VMware drive things through? VMware needs the ecosystem to help them with vCloud Hybrid Service, with vSAN, with NSX. Where does VMware have room to grow, or have they hit the limit for their growth because the competition's going to be there? By the way, quick little surprise, I'm expecting at least one acquisition from VMware at the show. It's something we've actually seen a couple of times with EMC lately, that they use the show to kind of bang off some announcements. So if I was going to have to put down a bet, I'd say something in the cloud space. Hear that DevOps might be, something that we'll hear more talked about, but it's still one of the best shows of the year. It's probably one of the largest infrastructure shows of the year. It's one of the largest cloud shows of the year. Many of the VExperts come. By the way, Dave, it's over 500 VExperts around the world, and many of them are paying on their own dime to come on into the show. I'm excited. I'm going to be part of something called Opening Acts on Sunday, which is being done with the V Brown Bag Group and the VM Underground Party, which is a fun party of really smart people in the virtualization community on Sunday. But Opening Acts, they're going to have 3 hours, total of six panels, and I'm going to be talking about cloud there, so people can definitely check that out at the site. And of course, theCUBE. So Dave, we'll be having everybody from Pat Gelsinger on down, going to have the Docker guys on, going to have broad spectrum of cloud, networking, storage, end user computing on theCUBE. So of course, everybody can always watch that on SiliconANGLE.tv.
Yeah, so VMworld is the premier enterprise event, Stu. A lot of diversity, a lot of good vibe going on at that show. Large crowds, what is it, 20K plus, 25,000?
20 to 23 last year.
Yeah, so good action going on there. As Stu said, check out theCUBE, we'll be there. Tweet us, and thanks for watching, everybody. Thanks, Stu, for coming on and giving us the preview.
Thanks, Dave, looking forward to the
show.
All right,
we'll see you next week. theCUBE is live at VMworld 2014, and thanks for watching, everybody. We'll see you next time.